अच्छा जी, वी हैव स्टिल 17 पार्टिसिपेंट्स, राइट? पीपल माइट कम, सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द क्वेश्चन दैट इज बीइंग आस्क्ड बाय अली गुल. सो ही इज आस्किंग अबाउट वेलोसिटी, द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ वेलोसिटी. Velocity is equal to, velocity is the rate at which money changes hand. Is the rate so how do we define the velocity? Velocity is the rate at which money changes the hands. So how many times a rupee is used in transaction is calculated by the velocity of money. This is the idea. How many hands a rupee is changing is to be calculated by the velocity of money, and velocity is equal to nominal GDP, which is the output production in the country divided by the available stock of money or money supply. So nominal GDP by money supply will give us the velocity of money. So how many times a rupee is used in transaction will be dependent on nominal GDP in the country or the output and the money supply. So what we can say that if 100 million is the output and 10 million is the money supply. So in a country with 100 million output and 10 million money supply, a rupee will change 10 hands, right? A rupee is used for 10 times in conducting transactions. So this is the average rate, or this is the rate at which money is a circulating hand. So in an economy with 100 million of output and 10 million of money supply, 1 rupee is to be used for, or 1 rupee will be changing hands 10 times. This is what the idea of velocity is, right? So let's say, now what does it tells? It tells, like, it shows that velocity is positively dependent on nominal GDP. What does it mean? When the nominal GDP or production of an economy increases, keeping this same, keeping money supply same, if nominal GDP goes up by any value, there would be increase in the income of the people. So when income of the people will increase, velocity will increase, because when the production increase, income increase, they are going to buy more goods and services. And in this way, more money will be changing hands in the economy. Similarly, if we reverse this scenario, like nominal GDP is same, but money supply, let's say if in nominal GDP is again 100, money supply is increasing to 20. So you would say that you would see that velocity will fall to 5. So now in a country where the output is 100 million and money supply is 20 million, the number of times a rupee is used in transaction is 5. So 5 is the velocity of money. So you can see here that if output is constant and money supply has been increased by the central bank, the velocity, the rate at which money changes hands, has declined from 10 to 5. So in this way, you would say that velocity is positively affected by nominal GDP and negatively affected by money supply. So this is what the concept of velocity is. The money demand has to be equal to the supply of money, right? What we derived. So we talked about asset market equilibrium. So this was our discussion topic, right? So we derived the condition from this, like money demand, subtracting it from money supply. So this was excess money demand plus this is demand for non-monetary asset in an economy, and this is supply of non-monetary asset. So we said that this is excess money demand and this is excess demand for non-monetary asset. And we deduced, or we tried to derive this idea that for the goods market to be in equilibrium, if money demand is equal to money supply, so we would say that goods market is in equilibrium. And if money demand is equal to money supply, it also means that demand for non-monetary asset is equal to supply of non-monetary asset. So we ended up discussing this condition that whenever the money demand in the economy is equal to money supply, it means that demand for non-monetary asset is also equal to supply of non-monetary asset. So this was the equilibrium condition that we ended up discussing that will help us understand the goods asset market equilibrium. So, and if we have to show this condition, if we have this condition using some mathematical identity, we can also do that, because the book has provided some ways to represent the equilibrium condition. So we can see it from here. So this was the equilibrium condition that we saw, that demand for money minus supply of money plus demand for non-monetary asset minus supply of non-monetary asset, both will sum to zero. Now, what does that mean? It means that money demand is equal to money supply, which implies that demand for non-monetary asset is equal to supply of non-monetary asset. So in both cases, in both the terms, demand and supply, demand of money is equal to supply of money, which implies that demand for non-monetary asset is equal to supply of non-monetary assets. So that is why the sum of the equation is equal to zero. And this is what the condition of asset market is. So we can read it as money demand minus money supply as excess demand for money plus excess demand for non-monetary asset, which is NMD minus NN, and both will sum to zero. So if money supply equals money demand, it also means that non-monetary asset supply is equal to non-monetary asset demand. Then entire asset, because from the very beginning of our discussion of asset market, we have been assuming that asset market equilibrium condition is divided, like asset market equilibrium condition is that money demand is equal to money supply. But in our discussion, we have categorized the asset into two categories. One is monetary asset, another one is non-monetary asset. So we would say that when the money demand is equal to money supply, it means that we are saying that the demand for non-monetary asset is also equal to the supply of non-monetary assets, which ultimately creates an equilibrium in the asset market. That is why we can show the asset market equilibrium condition like 7.9. On the left side, we have real money supply. Money supply divided by prices. And on the right side, we have real money demand. So in equation 7.9, which you can see in front of your screen, left side, which is M divided by P, this is the money supply. And on the right side, where we are writing it as money demand is a function of income and nominal interest rate. We know this from our previous discussion. And what is here in the like the Y variable, which is M over P, which is real money supply. M is determined by central bank, which is the total amount of money supply in the country. Pi E is the inflation rate, and it is fixed. The labor market determines the employment, and employment then determines the output. So this output has to be determined from goods market equilibrium. So given Y, which is supply, Y is what? The supply, production, income, the goods market equilibrium condition determines the interest rate. So this is how We can show the goods, how the goods market ultimately determines the interest rate, which is one of the variable in asset market equilibrium condition. And the labor market is going to determine the output in the economy. Inflation rate is going to remain fixed, and money supply is to be determined by the central banking authority. So this is a way of representing the asset market equilibrium. So let me show you the help of illustration. So we can when we are saying that now we are going to represent what the asset market equilibrium condition, we are going to write about asset market equilibrium condition. One condition is given above. Another way to like to write the same condition like this condition as can be the A can also be written as M over P. M over P is equal to real money supply, which means money supply in terms of goods and services it can buy. So real money supply, this has to be equal to what? The real money demand. So when money demand is a function of income and nominal interest rate. So this is how we can write it down. So we, now we can equate these two to get the asset market equilibrium condition. So we can write it this way, like M over P is equal to the income. M over P on the left side, we have real money supply. And on the right side, we have real money demand. So here we have income, and R plus pi E is equal to the nominal interest rate. We know this from our previous lecture. So this is real money supply. So what we are showing here is real money supply. Real money supply is equal to real money demand. So this is another way of representing the asset market equilibrium. So asset market is said to be in equilibrium when the real money supply is equal to real money demand in the economy. So which means, which in simple words mean, real money supply means the amount of goods that can be purchased or demanded with M amount of money. And this is under, M is under control of central bank. Y is to be determined through supply side, and interest rate has to be determined through goods market equilibrium. Pi E, which is inflation rate, expected inflation, it has to remain, it has to be like it is to be assumed to remain fixed. So pi E is fixed, and money supply is determined by the central bank. So this is the description of variables involved in the asset market equilibrium. Now another way to relate this is, you can see here like money supply and money demand are equal. So we are calling it as equilibrium condition, and we are denoting it with equation B. So equation B is another alternative way of representing the asset market equilibrium, where the left side is real money supply and on the right side we have real money demand. And when both are equal, the asset market is said to be in equilibrium. Now we can show this condition graphically as well. Like how do we do it? From our assumption that money supply is to be controlled by the central bank, right? We can draw a relationship between money supply and interest rate. So so we can place the real interest rate on vertical axis and quantity of money on horizontal axis. Now we know that money supply is under the control of central bank. So it would be decided by, let's say, here we are saying that money supply is 100 million and we are placing it on, because quantity of money is placed on horizontal axis. So we are saying that in an economy, the money supply is 100 million. the money supply is like 100 million. Let's say this is fixed. This is a fixed value. It has to be decided by a central bank. That is why it is a vertical line. Now, money demand would be a negative slope curve. Why it is a negative slope curve? You know that whenever the interest rate on all other assets, which means that interest rate on bonds, interest rate on stock will go up, keeping everything else same. If the interest rate would go up, people would prefer to demand less money because money pays no interest rate. And if the interest rate on alternative asset would increase, people will switch or convert the money that they hold in their portfolios in the form of other assets. So whenever the interest rate goes up, the demand for money goes down. So that is why the money demand curve would be a negative slope curve. Higher interest rate means lower money demand. And why money demand is getting lower? Because people are observing that all other assets are providing larger rate of return compared to the fixed rate of return, that is zero on money demand. So because money pays no interest rate, if interest rate on other asset will go up, people will choose to hold larger quantities of money in their portfolio. So whenever the interest rate on alternative asset increases, the money demand is going to decrease. Similarly, if the interest rate on alternative asset is going to fall, the money demand would increase. So in this way, we can say that there's an inverse relationship between interest rate and money demand, and we can draw a negative slope curve here to show the equilibrium of the asset market. Now you can see here that at the common point of intersection where money demand is equal to, the common point of intersection here, you can see in the diagram where money demand is equal to money supply. So this common point of intersection is known as asset market equilibrium. So this is going to decide the equilibrium rate of interest and the amount of money to be demanded and supplied in the economy. Because here you can see that 100 million is the value of money supply, and where this 100 million is intersecting with money demand, it means that money demand is also 100 million. So at this point, money, which we call E, money demand and money supply are equal. It means that asset market is in equilibrium. Now, why this R steric is the interest rate that clears the money market, the asset market, or why this R steric is the interest rate that is going to bring balance, or that is going to equilibrate the money demand and money supply in the economy? Why not any interest rate above this, and why not any interest rate lower than this? You can see it from here that if interest rate is R1 rather than R star, you would find out that a larger interest rate will mean that a larger interest rate would mean that lower money demand and larger money supply. So you can see here that money demand is only 600 and money supply is money demand is, let's say, 60 and money supply is 100. So there's a gap of 40. So 40 is excess supply of money. And whenever there is excess supply of money, the interest rate would fall to bring back again the balance between money demand and money supply. Our equilibrium will be recovered when the equilibrium interest rate is achieved. So when interest rate decreases from R1 to R steric in this way, so here the interest rate is decreasing. Why it is decreasing? Because supply of money is greater than the demand for money. Or you can say that money in circulation is larger than the amount of money people are demanding for their transaction. So this gap of 40 is causing interest rate to fall. And when the interest rate falls, again, it is equilibrating the demand and supply at this E point. And again, the money market would be in equilibrium, which means that asset market is in equilibrium. Now, if we consider any interest rate which is lower than R1, like R2, which is lower than equilibrium interest rate, at this R2 level of interest rate, you can see that supply of money is lower than the demand for money. Like demand for money is 120 and supply of money is only 100. So it means that people are willing to hold more money at a lower rate of interest than the amount of money available in the economy. So in this scenario where people are willing to hold more money than the amount of money available, that is being made available by the central bank. So how would it affect the interest rate? interest rate would go up. So in this scenario, interest rate would go up again to bring back the demand and supply forces into balance. So in this way, any interest rate that is lower than the equilibrium interest rate would cause money demand to be larger than the money supply. And in that scenario, because it's a free market, so interest rate is again going up to eliminate the gap between demand and supply, money demand and supply. So in this way, the equilibrium is realized at point E. So that is why we started our discussion from point E, which we were calling the asset market equilibrium. This is a condition that we started with. So we represented that asset market is in equilibrium when real money supply is equal to real money demand. Now, like before we conclude this chapter, we need to understand the relationship between, because if you just closely observe in this previous equation, we have described all the variables, like we have described this M is to be determined by central bank, this Y has to be determined by production function, this R interest rate has to be determined by goods market equilibrium, pi E, which is the expected inflation, is fixed. So what is remaining here? We have not yet emphasized the role of P, the price level. So this price level has to be discussed. So is like we'll be understanding, because our chapter was understanding the relationship between the fundamental elements of asset market, the demand and supply forces. And then we said that money has an important role in determining the prices. Now we'll be understanding the linkage between money supply and prices. Like, is there any linkage between the two? Are these two are irrelevant, are not dependent on each other? If they are dependent, then what are the ways in which they can affect each other? Does money affect the price level, or it is the price level that affects the money supply? So we need to understand this relationship. So to understand this relationship, what we can do is we can use this 7.9 to draw some meaningful conclusion. In what ways? Let's show on the whiteboard. When we are saying that after understanding the basic idea of the asset market, well, we are concluded with the asset market. Now we need to understand, is there any relationship between the price level and the money supply? So this is one of the key relationships that we have been looking from the beginning of our chapter, because we said that prices of most of the goods and services are listed in the units of money. So it means that larger money supply will have an impact on price level. So we can rewrite the equation of asset market equilibrium in this way: real money supply is equal to real money demand. This is the equilibrium condition. If we multiply and divide this by, you can multiply it with P and divide it with real money, like divide it with real money demand on both sides. So R plus pi E. So this would be like, so we are multiplying P and this. So you would see that so this function would cancel out with each other. It would lead to a value of P, and from here P would be cancelled out with P. What we will be left with? we'll be left with P as a function of, which means that price level is dependent on money supply divided by the money demand. So this is the equation that will be helpful in explaining the relationship between price level and money supply. So this we are calling it F, equation F, right? So now this equation is telling us, keeping everything else same, if the money supply increases by 1%, if money supply increases by 1%, the price level would also increases by 1%. So it means that this equation is summarizing the idea that if the general price level, like this equation is summarizing the idea that general price level and money supply are positively related with each other, and there's a one-to-one relationship between the two. A 1% increase in money supply implies a 1% increase in price level, keeping everything else same. So this is the relationship between price level and money supply. Like larger money printing by the central bank has an impact on the price level in the country. How? When money supply increases, there would be more money in the circulation, and there would be an impact on the prices. And from where the impact on prices is coming? Because the production is fixed, because this Y in the equation here, this Y is fixed, and these two are also fixed. What is happening? This whole term is fixed. So output is fixed, and there is more money supply which is made available from by the central bank. So larger amount of money is being injected, and every consumer, every business has got more money than the amount of goods that are available in the country. So a larger money supply, which is larger money supply, will ultimately bring an upward pressure on the prices, because the output is assumed to remain fixed. In this discussion, we are assuming that output is not changing, only the amount of money in circulation is increasing. So when the amount of money in circulation increases, it means that every consumer and business will be having more money to demand fixed quantity of goods and services. So when people have got more money, they would buy more goods and services, and ultimately with the fixed supply, if there's a larger demand because of larger money supply, there would be an upward pressure on price level. So this is what the relationship between money supply and prices is. Like a larger money supply mean larger purchases of goods and services, and already the supply is fixed. A larger money supply means larger demand of goods and services. And when the supply is fixed, larger demand means an upward pressure on the prices. So that is why you can see a positive relationship between money supply and the price level in the country. So this holds true when the output is constant. So this was the equilibrium condition from which we derived the relationship between general price level, prices of overall goods and services in the country, and the amount of money that is available, that is made available by the central bank. So the price level is the ratio of nominal money supply, which is M, because here M means the amount of money in terms of any currency unit. That is why it is called nominal money supply. And the price level is a ratio of nominal money supply to the real money demand. In the denominator, we have real money demand, and in the numerator, we have the money supply. So doubling money supply would double up the prices, given that all other factors are constant. Now, another way through which inflation rate can be predicted is based on the idea that you can rewrite the equation like 7.10 can be written in growth rate forms, and growth rate will give us what? On the left side we have the growth rate of prices, and on the right side we'll be having growth rate of money supply and the growth rate of real money demand. Section 7.10 to make it workable for us, like we can rewrite equation 7.10 by writing it in this way, delta P over P. Now on the left side we have delta P over P. So delta P is a change in price and it is divided with total price. So change in price divided by the total price will give us the growth rate of prices. Now growth rate of price is the inflation rate. So on the left side we have inflation rate, and on the right side we have the delta M divided by M, which means that this is growth rate of money supply. So growth rate of price level is positively associated with growth rate of money supply, and it is negatively related with or alternatively we can say that the growth rate of inflation is positively associated with money supply and negatively with real money demand. Or it can also be said as the growth rate of inflation is the difference between the growth rate of money supply and growth rate of real money demand. So if the money supply is larger than money demand, this would be a positive value and it would lead to bring a positive change in the inflation. If reverse is true, like if the growth rate of real money demand is larger than the real money supply, then this inflation rate would be lower than the previous case. So we can write it down in this way. What we have done here is simply by rewriting the same asset market equilibrium condition. Like what we are doing is here we are rewriting equation 7.10. What was 7.10? It is price level is equal to the ratio of money supply to real money demand. So R plus pi E. So this is the 7.10 that book is calling 7.10. Now this 7.10 can be written in growth rate form, like delta P over P. This is equal to inflation rate. So delta P over P is inflation rate. This is equal to delta M, which is change in money supply. If it is divided by total value, so it would give us the growth rate of money supply, minus delta change in real money demand divided by total money demand. So by rewriting the equation in this version, we can find out the growth rate of inflation rate. So this delta P over P is the inflation rate. So we can write it in simpler language, that inflation rate is the difference between
Excuse me, sir. Please screen share kare.
Ji, chale. So I'm again starting from the beginning, like how I started with equation 7.10. 7.10 summarizes the relationship between price level and money supply. And in this discussion, we saw that a 1% increase in money supply, keeping everything else same, will bring a 1% increase in price level. And we know the mechanism. And from that we moved on to this equation. Like we wrote 7.10 in growth rate form. So in growth rate form, it would look like this. Like on the left side, we have delta P, which is current price, which is the difference between current price and previous year price. So this would be change in price. And if it is divided by original today's price level, it will give us the growth rate of price level. Similarly, this is delta M, which is the money supply in previous year minus the money supply in current year. It has to be divided by money supply in current year. So it is the growth rate of money supply. So growth rate of inflation is dependent on growth rate of money supply minus the growth rate of money demand. So we can write this in simple way as like the inflation rate is the difference between growth rate of money supply and growth rate of money demand. Now what does it tell us? It tells us that if the growth rate of money demand is constant, an increase in the growth rate of money supply will bring a same increase in the inflation rate. So it is the difference between growth rate of money supply and money demand. So in other words, we are saying that this inflation, which can be represented with pi, inflation would go up when the growth rate of money supply would go up, right? Or alternatively, we can write from the above equation that inflation rate would go up when the growth rate of money supply is larger than the growth rate of real money demand, which can be written as y plus pi e. So if this growth rate is like, now what does it tell? It tells us that inflation would go up when growth rate of money supply is larger than the growth rate of real money demand.
Yes, sir.
So this was the relationship between money supply and price level, and how it was affected by the changes in money supply, right? So this is a last topic, I guess, we have in this chapter. So here, to predict inflation, we must forecast both money supply growth and real money demand growth. Like, because the inflation prediction is dependent on real money supply growth and real money demand growth, we need to predict both. So in long run equilibrium, we will have interest rate will be constant, and we need to have values of these three variables. Like here in 7.11, like inflation is dependent on the growth rate of money supply minus the growth rate of income multiplied by the income elasticity. This is income elasticity of money demand, right? So this is just for your know-how, that how the inflation is to be inflation rate has to be calculated when you have both the growth rate of money supply and the growth rate of income along with the income elasticity. So for example, here the book has taken the growth rate of income at 3% per year, elasticity 2/3, and growth rate of money supply 10% per year. So you can put these values here, like money supply is 10% minus 3% into 2/3. So 3 would cancel out with 3. So 2% will give us the value of 8%. So this would be the inflation rate in the year. So it is dependent on these values. Like we can perform some inflation. You need to have three unknowns from the equation. And what are those three unknowns? We need to have for predicting inflation, we can use the equation as like pi will tell us the inflation rate, and we are saying that it is dependent on growth rate of money supply, delta m over m, minus the income elasticity. This eta is the income elasticity. This is what? This is income elasticity. This would be already given. This would be already given. And we can also calculate it because we had a formula for it. It will, like, income elasticity is what? Income elasticity of money demand will give us the impact of increase in money demand with the 1% change in income. So growth rate of inflation is the difference between growth rate of money supply times minus the growth rate of income. So this delta y over y is the growth rate of income. Now we have values of all these variable, like we have delta m, like we have growth rate of money supply delta m over m, which is equal to, let's say, 10% in our example, and income elasticity is 2/3, and the third variable growth rate of income is already given. Growth rate of income is, let's say, 3%. Now we are asked to calculate the inflation rate. Now let's look at the above equation. How many unknowns are there? And like we have one unknown, right? We have we have to calculate inflation, and we have this these are the known values for calculating inflation. What is known in the scenario? We have growth rate of money supply, income elasticity, and the growth rate of income. So we'll be substituting back these values into above equation to get the inflation forecast. So inflation forecast, which is equal to pi, would be equal to 10%. So this is 10%. So 10% minus the 2/3 times 3%. So this would cancel out with this, and we would end up getting 10 minus 2, which is ultimately equal to 8%. So inflation pi would be equal to 8%. So this tells us what? This equation basically guide us about the forecast of inflation. So in every economy, with any value of because this income elasticity is going to this has to be given, like this is always given to you, like you need to find out the inflation using these three values. Like you need to have growth rate of money supply, you need to have income elasticity of money demand, and you also need to have the growth rate of income. So you would say that in an economy where money supply is growing with 10%, income elasticity is 2/3, and income is growing with 3%. So the inflation in that economy would be equal to 8% per year. So this is a way to calculate the inflation if you are provided with such values. Otherwise, it is very difficult, because without having information of money supply or without having information about income growth, you cannot calculate the inflation rate. So in our example, all three values were given. That is why we were able to calculate the inflation. But in practical, we just know the expected values of money supply and expected values of growth rate of income. That is why we, in practical, when we are trying to forecast inflation, we consider the expected rate of money supply and expected rate of income growth to calculate the expected inflation. This is actual inflation, because already we know a lot of information, but in real, we don't know much about the growth rate of money supply and the growth rate of income, because it is subject to change on quarterly basis, specifically if we talk about the money supply, because income is going to change after a year and the money supply will change in a quarter. So this is actual inflation that we are calculating here. We are left with just one more topic of this chapter. So let's this is the application, money growth and inflation, right? So we are not going to talk about application, because this is a principles course, and then you can read it yourself as well. Now, this is the last topic of our chapter, like expected inflation rate and the nominal interest rate. Like for a given real interest rate, like for a fixed real interest rate, expected inflation determines the nominal interest rate. Like you can see it from here. We have been discussing it from our second chapter of this course, where we have described that nominal interest rate is the sum of real interest rate plus expected inflation. And you would also find out in practical that whenever there is an inflation in the economy, the interest rate is being raised to curtail down the inflation. But generally, this expected inflation is unknown. So people make forecast of it to understand, like to try to find out like what will be the inflation after 1 month or after a year. So like there are various ways to define it. Let's write code. Can you see the whiteboard? So we are saying is now we are going to end our discussion with expected inflation and the nominal interest rate. Expected inflation. Because generally inflation is not easy to forecast. So it means actual inflation is not known. That is why we are going to take into consideration expected inflation and its relationship and the nominal interest rate. Now these two are the key variables in our discussion. Because inflation, like in our previous chapter, we said that real interest rate is the difference between nominal interest rate and inflation. But we know that this inflation is not known. So this inflation is actually we take expected inflation because this is unknown. So we can write it down like real expected rate of inflation is the difference between nominal interest rate and expected inflation. So we can also write it this way, like nominal interest rate is nominal interest rate is the sum of real interest rate plus expected inflation. So this is, let's say, A. Now this A guides us about like the, if we assume that pi e is fixed, pi e is expected inflation is fixed. So it means that any movement in, if the nominal interest rate would go up, then it means that there would be an equivalent increase in the real interest rate. Why? Because we are assuming that expected inflation is fixed. So if the nominal interest rate would go up, real interest rate would go up. If the expected inflation is same, if it is fixed. If it is not fixed, then this does not hold true. It would be wrong to assume like that nominal interest rate moves with the same magnitude like the real interest. Like we are saying here that 1% increase in nominal interest rate would bring a 1% 1% increase in real interest rate if and only if the expected inflation is at its fixed value, right? So this is a way of explaining the relationship between nominal interest rate and real interest rate. Because we are assuming the expected inflation is remaining same. But if you just observe in practical, if you just observe in real, so you would find out that that in this I is in control. This is I, which we are calling nominal interest rate, which is the interest rate that banks pay you on your deposit. So this interest rate is basically the main variable, like in determining, in affecting the another variable that we are saying expected inflation. How, let's say, these days interest rate has been kept lower by the central bank, State Bank of Pakistan. Like State Bank of Pakistan has kept the interest rate lower to 7%. Because they know that inflation, expected inflation in the year is going to fall. So it means that any movement in the expected inflation is to be adjusted by the central bank in movement with the interest rate. So this is how it works, right? So there's a direct relationship with, like, there's an inverse relationship rather. Whenever the economy is experiencing a larger inflation, the central bank is going to increase the nominal interest rate. And whenever the economy is going to experience a lower inflation, central bank is going to cut down the interest rate, or vice versa. Like when the inflation forecast is lower in the current year, right? When the inflation forecast is lower, like in this case, when the inflation is lower, interest rate would be kept lower so that more people could borrow and more people can invest in economy and demand would increase. But in this case, when the inflation is expected to be larger in the future, central bank would curtail the inflation by raising the interest rate. And while raising the interest rate, central bank is trying to compress the aggregate demand so that very few people can borrow at a larger interest rate. And when there are few people who can borrow, there are very few people who can invest in the economy. So in this way, expected inflation and the nominal interest rate are interconnected with each other.